Namaste everyone. I hope you're doing all right, and I hope you've found that magical balance between cooking, cleaning, spending time with your family, and all of the work that you know one has to do, whether it's writing code or making presentations. These are definitely interesting times, and today on Bharatvarta, we're going to put a few of our cultural and economic realities under the lens and examine how we got here and where we're headed. Now, I know that sounds too broad, and if it does, it's because I'm talking about globalization. So I grew up in the 90s, and those of my generation have witnessed a time before, you know, burgers and branded clothes and cable TV, a time before high-speed internet and instant virality or memes. We've experienced the riches of globalization from many, many different perspectives. From the more material to, you know, the rather subliminal elements of it. And yet, as the world is in the grip of a pandemic right now, we are being forced to evaluate some of our choices, right? And really examine the baggage that has come with much of this prosperity. To discuss this fascinating topic, I have a stellar lineup of guests today on this podcast. First up, we have Rajiv Mantri. You've heard from Rajiv before. He's an investor at Navam Capital, and he's a sought-after political commentator as well. He's been proven right on a bunch of things, you know, from the price of crude occasionally to what or when the government might do at certain times. So, hi, Rajiv. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Roshan. Thanks for having me.
All right. So, we have our resident guest extraordinaire, Ashish Chandorkar, as well, man for all seasons. Ashish loves his poha as much as he does talking to us about public policy and politics. He also has a special interest in manufacturing, which could be, you know, particularly relevant in today's podcast. Hey, Ashish.
Hey, Gary. Hi. And I think poha is, I think, the will always remain quintessentially Indian. So that's one solace.
Right. So finally, we have Srivatsa Subarna, who's making his debut on today's podcast. Srivatsa, or Vatsa as we like to call him, is an IT industry veteran, and he's observed the whole global outsourcing business from, you know, very close quarters. And he's been at the vanguard of things like, you know, new technologies like big data analytics and so on. Hi, Vatsa. Welcome to the show finally.
Hey, hi, Roshan. Thanks for having me.
So, guys, very good to have you all on this episode. Now, before we delve right in, I want to go around the table and have like a quick answer from each of you, right? What do you miss from the pre-globalized or relatively less globalized world, right? Short answers only. We'll start with Rajiv.
Well, I would say certainly with globalization, we've seen a certain homogenization of cultures and the distinctiveness of each country, the distinctiveness of each region. Mm-hmm. Kind of gets overrun with globalization. So I certainly miss that because, you know, once you travel through so many countries, all you see is, you know, McDonald's and Zara stores and the same kind of products, right? Same kind of experiences.
Food or fashion.
It was probably a different world when there was no globalization. So sometimes I wonder what that might have been like.
Right. Ashish?
So, since I grew up in exactly that world, see, the world used to be a aggregation, a bottom-up aggregation of local cultures. And when I say culture, you mean language, food, customs, implicit knowledge, which was not documented, but you knew stuff about your region, about your geography. And the world was essentially an aggregation of that. Now it's a top-down world in the last, let's say, 2.5 decades, where everyone understands everyone else in the world on a few broad themes. So the decay of the local specialities in terms of the cultural references is, I think, what I miss most.
Right. Srivatsa?
Yes, so I kind of agree with Rajiv in the sense that if you kind of travel abroad, you see that most cities are, you know, kind of like clones of each other. If you visit, say, a downtown, you see essentially the same brands. The local element is kind of missing, which was quite big earlier. That is what I essentially missed from the pre-globalized world.
Yeah, I think that's a fair point, and everyone brought out the same, which is that our cities are starting to look increasingly similar, right? Whether it's New York or Bombay, to a certain extent, there is the same kind of food, fashion, culture, etc. Rajiv, I want to start with you. From an economic standpoint, you know, how have we done on balance in this globalized world, right? Clearly, India has gained more than it has lost. But what do you see as some of those things that we could have done better on?
So, let's start with services. We all know the success story there. India, even today, has probably a $100 billion plus services export industry, contributes probably about 20-25% of our total exports. And this is an industry that's grown from scratch. So from a standing start around two and a half decades ago, to where it is today. So an incredible story of wealth creation, job creation, several multi-millionaires created in India, not to speak of billionaires, but even early employees of some of the IT companies have become very, very wealthy. So on the services side, a massive sort of benefit for India that way. On the manufacturing side, less so. And that, you know, I would say it's a mixture of probably India's own policy choices, as well as not sort of, you know, there is a certain argument coming now that India could have taken a slightly more mercantilist approach, where instead of opening up the country completely, we could have calibrated a little bit and opened for foreign investment, but not for foreign imports, or rather accept investment from foreign companies, but don't freely import their products. So essentially a combination of some combination of tariffs plus FDI. So maybe a slightly more mercantilist approach would have served us better. And this is a topic of current debate. Obviously, those who are tied to the orthodox view that all trade is good support the view that India should not have tariffs. There are other arguments that India should have tariffs because we need to create jobs here, and manufacturing jobs will require us to keep some level of tariffs so that our own industries can grow here. But I think this government in particular has hit upon an interesting mix where we are opening up FDI. So if you track over the last 5-6 years, the extent to which FDI has come up in all different industries, I think it's been pretty remarkable, the degree to which India has opened up to FDI, and that is reflected in the FDI numbers as well. I think in calendar year 2019, we crossed, I think, 60-65 billion of FDI, which is a record for India. So that is an interesting strategy. Let's see how that plays out. In obviously, globalization now, the way it has been in the last 20 years, probably the next 10-20 years will be very different. But I think the current approach is probably an interesting tangent to take, an interesting path to try out for India, for as far as manufacturing is concerned.
Yeah, I mean, so one of the implicit assumptions that we live in this globalized world is, you know, free trade, market economy, right? And to that extent, we hear arguments that India has become sort of a dumping ground, a petri dish for, you know, imported medicine or consumer electronics, etc. And with this sort of like a wave of regionalism, localism coming through, Ashish, I want to talk to you about, you know, how do we deal with this? I mean, is, you know, some of the things that Rajiv talks about, like, you know, tariffs and such, are those things in order right now? I mean, do you see that, happening more so going forward?
See, in India's case, the trade structures, the way they have been traditionally built, have not really helped us a lot, right? So we joined free trade agreements with, say, ASEAN countries or with Japan almost a decade ago. And none of that has helped us really. I mean, our trade deficit with these countries have only grown. In fact, we have been more liberal in reducing tariffs or opening up our markets. But the reciprocity has not been there. Also, India has the need for services markets being opened up, which never happens, right? So you typically typically you'll see that in a FTA, most countries will talk about free capital movement or but the free resource movement never includes labor as such, which really is not very useful for the Indian economy as such. So we have tried the approach of the FTAs, and you know, when it did not sign the RCEP a few months ago, there was a lot of furor about the decision. But the fact is that these FTAs haven't really helped us being more competitive. So I think that argument should have been settled by now. But clearly the no tariff free open border lobby is very strong. So I think this point keeps coming up over and over again. The fact is that our competitiveness is low due to domestic factors, and whether you trade or not, that point anyway has to be addressed. And that's more about reforms on the factor market side within India. So to that extent, I would say that the current trade structure is not what we should be worried about, because anyway, in the post-COVID world, some of these realities will anyway change as such, right? And what India should look at is to protect own interests and to ensure that new markets open up where our strength lies, which is in services. And also, we should be able to attract new manufacturing facilities to India, which again should be at least a relatively easier task, if not on an absolute terms, but relatively it should be easier now to ask companies to diversify and choose India as a destination. So I think India's trade interest should be guided by our own. The trade policy should be guided by our own interests, and I think this is the right time to make some of those changes.
Right, Ashish. Before we proceed further, I know some of this will be relevant going forward as well. In your opinion, what do you consider three or four things as characteristics of this globalized world? You know, free trade is one thing that we take as an implicit assumption. Anything else, just to set the context?
Yeah. See, free trade, Gary, eventually becomes a doctrinaire approach, right? So the free trade is not just about trade, but then it becomes about open borders, about a few common principles that govern the world. So it also impacts geopolitics, refugees, movement of being more politically correct about things, looking at a common culture across the world, right? So that homogenization of the thought process of people at large, I think that is the first impact and of a free trade type of a structure. Secondly, geopolitics wise, obviously a few countries become more powerful. US obviously was the single pole after the Cold War, but then China in the last couple of decades has tried to mount some challenge. And of course, with their own alleged 100-year marathon where they want to lead the world by 2050 or so, they've tried hard to become the counter to the US using their own capital and their own strengths around manufacturing and the fact that they can govern their economy very closely. The third aspect is that the control, when you let goods move across borders, your control over certain goods becomes very, very low. And when there is a risk situation or a problem situation like what we are facing today, countries realize that you can't even make masks and ventilators in your own country because you let China make them many years ago, right? So you have zero capacity to do even basic stuff what will be needed to protect your own borders. So I think the free trade issue has to be seen in the light with the sovereign control for a country over its own borders and the larger picture of what you need to be self-sufficient on a bad day. On a good day, everything is fine. Things can flow in from Shanghai, but what happens on a bad day? I think those are the questions which arise from the globalization process over the last couple of decades.
Yeah, it's
also,
so...
I
was going to come to you as well, Rajiv. Ashish spoke about this quest for efficiency, right? And, how things have become very complex, right? Our systems are complex and there's a lot of added fragility in the system, right? Simple things like he mentioned, masks and PPE as such, or even pieces of stationery could come from 40 different places. Clearly, China has gained a lot from this, right? But do you see that trend shifting, Rajiv?
No, certainly for what can be characterized as essential goods, I think there will be a serious rethink. It would only be sensible. Also, what's worth mulling over is that size matters in trade, right? So trade theory, as we understand it, as sort of economists have put it out. So when you're looking at small countries, so you know, for example, if it's Tunisia or if it's Botswana or if it's Singapore or some other small country like that, the size factor makes things very different when you apply that same framework onto a country like India, which is very, very large. So in terms of population, if you rank the countries, obviously China is still number one, India is two, and the number three country is the US, which is about 1/4 the size of India. And if you go further down the list, there is an even bigger gap. There are not too many countries between India, and there's a vast gap between China, India and the rest of the world. And obviously, countries which have such a large population are very large consumers. So these countries also have job needs. At the same time, they also able to provide consumption on a very large scale. So obviously, China and India put together as a consumer market would be about 40% of the world population. So the size factor when it comes to trade. So can we apply the same rules that we apply to a small country to a vast nation like this? Probably not, because a sovereign of that size will have its own considerations in terms of job creation as well. And we can and should try to get something extra out, because we have more bargaining power compared to a small country.
Yeah, definitely. So moving to, IT outsourcing now, right? Ashish mentioned competitiveness, services, and so on. Vatsa, I want to come to you and talk about IT outsourcing. It has created, tremendous value for India, not just from a knowledge and skill set perspective, but also in terms of, let's say, self-esteem, right? It's created the entire middle class as we know it right now. Right. We've learned to, compete with the best of the world. And yet, often you see analysts and commentators as such, drawing their knives out in times of a downturn like this. Is there a legit reason for people to kind of whine about lack of innovation per se? Or is it just that, this kind of innovation that they expect, not something that they're seeing?
Sure. So before I start, one thing I've been hearing for a long time in the IT industry is something called business continuity planning. And if you see the way the industry has managed this whole COVID situation with, people fantastic. Working from home, it's pretty amazing. So to that extent, I think the industry has done pretty well on that front.
Yeah.
Coming to the innovation side, right? So there are usually different kinds
of innovation. Sorry, I just want to add on that, right? I mean, how much is it? I think 3 million or odd people have moved work from home and systems are continuing to run, right? So, I mean, that's pretty remarkable.
It's huge scale. I mean, companies are sending, desktops home, and, those who have laptops, they're working from home. The internet infrastructure has held up. So I would say it's a pretty amazing achievement in that sense. Coming to innovation, right? So there are different kinds of innovation. I think where the Indian IT industry is good, and I would say not just the IT industry, even if you look at some of the, unicorns in this country, whether it's, Flipkart or Ola, they've taken on existing business models and made, marginal changes so that they succeed in India. So things like, adding cash on delivery, which is probably not there anywhere else in the world. That's probably the only innovation I can think that a Flipkart has done, say, over an Amazon, right? So Indian companies are traditionally very good at incremental innovation, which is even true for IT services per se. So even when, large processes or teams have been moved from on-site to India, we've done it at a lower cost and with fewer people. Where I think the criticism is valid is that we are not very good at, some sort of disruptive or radical innovation. So, whether it's coming up with a new product like iPhone, phones have already existed, smartphones existed, there were Palms, there were Blackberries, but iPhone came and completely disrupted that market. it is that kind of disruption which is missing in India. It's not due to the people per se, because if you look at, you know, the R&D centers that global companies have set up in India, for instance, companies like Symantec, they have a big chunk of their patents being filed from the India, right? It's to do with a couple of things, I think. One is, for a long time, we didn't have very good, you know, IP protection, patent protection. So it was very easy to get ripped off. And that's why, you know, Indian companies never really invested in products per se. But, you know, with the overall shift in technology and, you know, moving to a much better patent regime, that is kind of changing. So you do see some product companies coming out of India. The other thing I think is a lot of our MSME space is very focused on survival, and you know, they're just living quarter by quarter. So it's really hard to focus on things like innovation and disrupting the market in that state. So it's a fair criticism. Some of the larger companies in India who have built up, you know, huge cash reserves, they have not gone ahead, built products, or, you know, done something really innovative. But at the same time, a lot of it is to do with, you know, more domestic factors. So coming back to some of, you know, what Ashish was referring to early with respect to domestic talent.
Yeah, so I want to unpack that a little bit, right? So, see, considering the arbitrage that we had, I don't know what would have been a more obvious kind of a business to build, right? You know, I kind of agree with the incremental innovation bit that you mentioned. But, hey, I mean, upskilling lakhs and lakhs of people, entire generations of people on everything from Java to Hadoop, you know, I don't think that is incremental by any stretch, right? So I want to cue Ashish in on that same point. I mean, anything from a policy perspective that we could have done to kind of spur product growth as such, Ashish, product and IP growth in India?
See, my view is that there's a lot of focus on this area. I think some of the times things take their own natural course, right? I think the IT industry has developed mainly because there was no political intervention, or there was no interest from the government of any vintage to really do anything for the industry. And that's how I think the industry took an advantage of that in terms of working around the usual nightmares which the manufacturing companies have to face when the factors of production are not in place, right? So I think the focus on products is, while I think it is an intellectually stimulating discussion, the fact is that the jobs can still continue to grow on the services side. Even like with this lockdown, one thing which has changed is that the world now understands that you can build trust remotely, right? One of the reasons why several services are not digitized and you still go face to face. Like, why do you go and meet a doctor? Why do you want to work with an accountant who you have seen, right? I mean, will you share your financial data with say an accounting firm in which you know no one, right? So I think those questions have always been there, and it's been cited that trust can only be built when you work together or you see people. But that's not, with this particular situation, we have seen that a lot of those services can actually be delivered remotely, right? So can we focus even more on, say, telemedicine, on financial services, where access and proximity are not put together? And I think the opportunity even in that field is too high. I think maybe the products will come maybe in a different area altogether, right? These may not be conventional products in terms of the SaaS platforms or social media networks and so on, but maybe there's something else which we can invest on where India can leverage from a unique advantage of having scale in services. I remember Rajiv has written a very good article on this, on how 5G proliferation can drive some of these changes. Maybe Rajiv can throw more light about what I'm talking about.
Yeah. So that one of my working themes, Ashish, on virtualization and how that can enable trade and local consumer services. But just before that, I want to talk about this aspect of incremental versus breakthrough innovation and so on. Very, very old debate in India. But I think at the root cause of that is the kind of misallocation of human capital and weakness of education system in the country, which is kind of really hamstringing us. Now, when I say misallocation of human capital, well, it's not, that's maybe not the the precise way to say it. But if you look at what's called the GCC business in India, the Global Capability Center business, which is essentially the R&D outpost of all the Fortune Global 500 companies, the likes of Boeing, Caterpillar, 3M, everybody who's doing R&D work in Bangalore and Hyderabad. The sheer size of that business is about a $28 billion business employing about 1 million people. Okay, so now where are those 1 million people coming from?
Yeah.
They're coming from the Indian education system, which anyway, on a per capita basis, is not producing that many researchers and scientists. And most of our researchers and scientists are either working in the GCC business, essentially for global 500 companies solving global problems, or they are migrating, right? So they are going to Western countries, they're going to Europe, the US, Canada, even Australia nowadays, taking up research positions, taking up academic positions, and we are losing talent like that. So as a nation, I do think this is damaging us. Now the question is, what can we do about it? Obviously, you know, every individual is a free agent. You can't impose something on them as a government, right? But this is where the aspect of policy failure comes in, because for too long the government has been centered on getting remittances. We're not thinking bigger. We are just happy that we are sending our talent abroad, and then that talent sends back remittances, and remittances now are pretty massive in the Indian context, running into tens of billions of dollars, and we are happy with that. So somewhere we all need to raise our ambitions. The government needs to raise its ambitions and say that, you know, we want Indian talent to stay here, and not just Indian talent, but we want to attract talent from the rest of the world, including Southeast Asia, including East Asia. So it really, in my view, is a human capital problem. And until we stop losing people, I don't think we will be able to make that leap into, you know, what can be called as 0-to-1 innovation rather than 1-to-N, or, you know, leaving that path of tweaking Amazon's yeah. model or Uber's model and doing something that is truly breakthrough.
Yeah.
And let me quickly talk about the virtualization bit also, Carrie.
Yeah, sure.
So essentially, the kind of technologies that are coming up now, whether it is, you know, we are all experiencing this. Some of the friends in the technology world I've been seeing on my Twitter timeline, they're already doing yoga classes with instructors from India on Zoom. So as a forcing function, this COVID-19 event has already sensitized people that many classes, many sort of group exercises, etc., can be done virtually. It was already happening, but it's gotten accelerated. So what happens now once it settles down? People may continue with the same, or they may go back to their local yoga instructor, right? But I think slowly over time, we will start seeing technologies that will kind of get rid of the bias that people have that it should all be, you know, in person. So let's talk about something called, you know, holograms. Right now we are doing, let's say, a yoga class on Zoom. Tomorrow there could be a cheap and very effective way of doing it with a hologram, and the person behind the hologram could be sitting anywhere in the world. So if you're doing a yoga class, would you rather do it with a Bihar school of yoga instructor who's sitting in Bihar, or would you rather do it with someone, you know, in California or in New York? By the same token, if you're getting a haircut, and this is what I've written about in my Mint article, I said getting a haircut in many Western countries is a very expensive affair. So in Manhattan, you would pay probably $50 for a haircut. But with some combination of mixed reality, augmented reality, and robotics to go with that, could robots be giving us haircuts for a much lower price? These things sound fanciful today, but I think this will come in the future, where local consumer services will be deliverable because of these new technologies.
Yeah, I mean, you spoke about a lot of interesting points there, and I think each of them is a rabbit hole by themselves, right? I mean, you spoke about, you know, global innovation, R&D hubs moving to India, which has been happening, I feel like, for the last 5-10 years at a rapid pace. You spoke about how post-COVID, you know, we'll move into this sort of a one-world situation again, a remote where remote capabilities are, you know, a lot more accelerated. Ashish, how much of this do you think will impact things like manufacturing? Because at this point of time, I'm still looking at it from a services perspective on what knowledge or what value we can add, you know, across borders. How much of this do you think post-COVID will impact manufacturing as such?
See, one good thing about even how the manufacturing is evolving is that a lot of the design aspect of it is also digitized now, right? So I think even in the first few legs of manufacturing itself, like what Rajiv was alluding to in terms of creating digital clones and so on, I think a lot of that process can still be done remotely, right? So in that sense, India has an advantage, and given that R&D centers are already here for even for large manufacturing firms, part of that process can anyway be done in India, which is up to the design stage, right? I think what matters is to get the main components of supply chains back to India, or set them afresh in India in some cases. See, that is where we will need some government intervention. It is not so much on the services side. On the manufacturing side, maybe there's a case for the government to create a task force to target maybe top 10 or top 100 manufacturers globally and invite them to India to coexist with their software design facilities, or basically create the environment in a way where they can choose the locations where they want to be in, and then involve the states to ensure that the permissions are expedited, the land availability is ensured, power and water connections are given fast, right? Maybe if there's a way to create some labor arbitrage, in terms of relaxing rules temporarily in a specific way, maybe that can be explored. The interest, tax rates are already now competitive with the changes which happened in September, which the finance minister had announced. So I think some of this has to be done very, very aggressively. And I think this is a good point as well, where there are two drivers here. One is, of course, that India needs to be self-sufficient on some of the key things. I mean, say for example, Carrie, you were talking about PPEs or simple stuff like masks, and you know, add pharma to that, for example, right? I mean, there's no reason for us to be not to be dependent on China for some of these things, or any other country. I mean, not just China as such. The second aspect is that for the global manufacturing firms, they need to also create a business continuity plan for their businesses, right? They will also need to find a way to get into countries where, let's say, the next pandemic has lesser impact. So which are those countries? And I think the one good thing is that our coupling with China is probably the lowest amongst all potential manufacturing destinations, right? So I think it's only the South Asian countries which aren't as exposed to China directly. While China was trying to change that through the OBOR initiatives, etc., I think it remains to be seen if some of those investments will still continue to flow in or not, and how the governments will react to attracting Chinese capital. So the fact is that the South Asian countries are fairly well placed, and then India is the only country which then offers the right scale and the right kind of talent across a range of things. So I think that focus on getting key manufacturing supply lines set up in India is what should be the priority for the government in the next few months to come.
Yeah, so much about what you spoke, Ashish, the potential value in manufacturing depends on, you know, access and infrastructure. And both of these are, could entirely be policy driven, right? One thing I also want to talk about is the, you know, social and cultural aspects of some of these economic things that we're talking about, because I feel that they're sort of tightly coupled, right? Just last week, we saw Shinzo Abe, the Prime Minister of Japan, announce a $2 billion fund to get companies out of China, right? Vatsa, how much of this is economic, and how much of this do you see as a sort of a back to the roots, cultural, localism led movement?
So the way I look at it is mostly economic. Some of it is going back to the cultural roots. Some of it is you know, countries wanting to have control over their own supply chain and you know, more control over essentials and stuff like that. But a bit of it is economic and dressed up culturally. So you do see instances, you know, where people want things. For example, if you're looking at tech service providers and, you know, you look at European countries, there is an ask for them, you know, to deliver some of the deliverables in local language. So it appears as it is kind of going back to the roots, but it is, you know, economic in the sense that they want to support their local service providers more.
Yeah, so one thing that we have seen is a rise in inequalities, right? And, you know, consequently, we're seeing local businesses or local communities being displaced or being left out in this whole prosperity as such. Nassim Taleb has spoken a fair bit about this, and he says, you know, the world has lost its island properties due to globalization, and there's kind of an increased skewing towards a winner-takes-all effect. So in light of this, is there a legit reason for politicians and leaders to sort of even the scale through some kind of a diktat or fiat, Rajiv?
So I think there will be a clamor for that. And let's see how it falls out. But inequality in and of itself, now how much of it is driven by globalization is really open question according to me. And I think in the last 10 years at least, it has got more to do with competition law. I think it has got more to do with the regulation of digital businesses than it has to do with globalization per se.
Okay. And
because if you look at the competition law regime as it stands, so India has kind of adopted the European sort of approach. The US has a slightly different approach than Europe, but generally they look at essentially dominance of a market. So if a firm is dominant in a market, that usually is seen as a case of anti-competitive intervention, or makes the ground for anti-competitive intervention. But the way digital companies have grown, the definition of market itself is nebulous, because these are network-driven companies. They tend to be in multiple things. So I don't think it's been easy to define. Whether Facebook, even today, people are debating, is Facebook a media company? Is Facebook an advertising company? Is it a tech company? And then when you allow tech monopolies like that to rise, the gains of those monopolies vest in the hands of very few people. And then, you know, you have people who are worth like tens of billions of dollars or hundreds of millions of dollars just by even early employees become billionaires. At the same time, the effect of that on the marketplace is not benign. What digital advertising has done to newspapers, for example,
great point.
There are many issues with that, and of course, no one has the answer to it yet.
Yeah, I mean, we're seeing a definite shift in the power, right? I mean, Wall Street money has definitely moved more towards the tech and VC community at this point of time, at least from a focus perspective, right? And beyond the money, also, I feel like the power of platforms to control narrative, right, which erstwhile rested in the hands of media companies, is a key thing, right, in this entire shifting of power, so to speak. And we're seeing, you know, a lot of technologists and VCs get increasingly political as well, because they kind of recognize this shift too. So do you think of this as an important shift, Vatsa? I mean, what do you think will happen, right? So do you think we'll have a coder/VC president or prime minister in the world anytime soon?
So I think, Roshan, you're right on the fact that, you know, the platforms, social media platforms have definitely shifted the power. People who have good content are able to connect, you know, to a large number of people. are thriving on social media, and some of the older voices are slowly becoming irrelevant, right? What has also happened, I think, is that voters are giving sort of more credence and credibility to people who have sort of skin in the game, people who have done it in the past, people who have run businesses in the past. They are seen as more credible than those who just theorize.
Very interesting. Right?
That's a big shift, I think, we've seen in the last 5 to 7 years globally, right?
No, that's a very interesting point. Just to add to that, I think Naval Ravikant had a tweet this morning, which is, you know, I mean, who would you choose as the leader of your nation or your, you know, someone who would rule your country? And he had about four options: career politician, academic, and one of the options was an entrepreneur or a businessman. And I think 70% of the votes went to the entrepreneur or businessman option, even considering that, you know, his audience is skewed more towards the startup friendly and that kind of a crowd. I thought that was a very interesting sort of a pull.
No, I'll also say, Gary, on the inequality bit, we also have to keep in mind what central banks in the world have been doing. So the response to the global financial crisis, the scale on which central banks have intervened in financial markets, this is something for which there is no playbook, there is no theory, there is nothing. When a central bank goes in and starts buying equities, it starts buying junk bonds. You know what is really going on here? Like, you know, anyone who knows how all this will end, well, either they are very confident or they are just making things up.
Yeah, I mean, a lot
think,
of the
and I do think that you know, creating money on this scale, you know, you push a button, there's this video of Ben Bernanke that's been going around, where somebody asks him that, you know, what do you do? He says, we just push a button and we create money electronically. And when you create money electronically like that, usually it will sooner or later flow into risk assets.
Right.
Those risk assets are, you know, essentially technology companies, private or public.
Right. No, I'm going to come to that point. That's a very interesting point, Rajiv, about, you know, all these large institutions and, you know, the doctrine of interventionism in some sense, right? What's up? I want to come back to you again. Do you want to complete what you were saying? Sorry.
Yeah, sure. So the thing is, you know, if you are coming back to your question, whether, you know, we will see a VC or kind of a tech entrepreneur in a political leadership role soon. If you're looking at, you know, what a good VC is or what a good tech entrepreneur is, what are their characteristics, right? They're usually very curious to learn, open-minded in the way they think. They can think of on their feet. They can think of the relevance of something they're doing now in a completely unrelated field. So they think kind of 10 steps ahead. They have very high levels of energy and they're extremely hardworking. Right, they're very good at assessing risk and reward. They're very involved in whatever they do. Right now, if you look at a lot of these characteristics, they also apply to politicians who are very good. PM Modi is a hardworking prime minister who is never behind the curve on, you know, a lot of topics. Right. In addition to that, a good politician also has a strong emotional connect with people. So, do I see a pure technocrat becoming a PM? Probably not in the next 5 to 10 years. But what I do see happening is that there will be more and more technocrats who will be part of sort of the executive, either in formal or informal roles. And at some point, probably 10, 15 years down the line, we may see a, you know, first technocrat sort of prime minister or president in a large country.
Yeah, I mean, it's very interesting that you bring that up, right? Because I certainly am noticing a lot more technocrat-oriented sort of leaders as such, whether it's PM Modi himself, right? So it's a pretty interesting shift from a statesman to a sort of a technocrat in that sense. Also, Ashish, I mean, how much of this anger that we are seeing, right, whether due to inequalities or displacement and so on, how much of this anger is, you know, kind of misdirected, right? So how much of this is actually anger towards something like a UN or IMF or you know, WHO, which has had a really poor showing in the, you know, current crisis, right? How much of this is directed towards those kind of organizations, their interventionism, and the people who kind of carry out their whims and fancies at a local level?
So, while the current in the current crisis carry the role of WHO is certainly under scanner. I mean, as late as January 14th, they were saying that the disease doesn't spread by human contact. So clearly, they have a lot to answer. And what will also happen is that in the coming months, several international multilateral institutions will be questioned for their relevance in this type of world where globalization will recede. I mean, even if there's no globalization per se, the fact is that countries will look after their interests even more fiercely in the times to come, right? So the role of multilateral organizations as an overriding bodies will certainly come into question. I mean, look at Security Council. The Security Council doesn't have India despite us being a nuclear power. Look at G7. G7 still has countries which with a great Western presentation. So several of the bodies, I mean, what's the purpose they are serving, right? And why should someone fund them if they will not step up to the task when there's a genuine problem here? The US President Donald Trump has already cut, has already announced that he will be cutting the funding for WHO. Some vision is expected the times to come. It is also an opportunity for other countries, more friendly countries, to get together and create new forms of cooperation and develop bodies which will be genuinely useful to those countries. I mean, for example, Quad is something which has been discussed on the defense side. Can that evolve as in a more formal way, potentially? We'll have to see. India had championed an international solar alliance along with France, which has done okay so far, but much more can happen there in terms of promoting renewable energy, for example. So the role and the nature of the multilateral bodies will change rather than from political control trying to push the agenda of a few economists or a few regimes of the world. The countries will get together to promote important but common interests which are limited to a given sector, which don't impinge on sovereignty, yet they allow some level of cooperation for research and development and advancement of technology. But it will be less political going forward.
Yeah, I mean, some of the advice as well, right? I mean, recently we had Geeta Gopinath of the IMF saying that, hey, fiscal stimulus is in order, and then at the same time saying that, you know, current deficit is something that we have to worry about, right? So things like this, where, you know, non-skin in the game, purely intellectual arguments that impact local communities, I think will probably go away, right? I mean, or will probably reduce. And local alliances like the kinds you mentioned, Ashish, would be the order of the day going forward. Rajiv, I want to come to you as we wind up, right? How much of this is an overreaction of people? Right. I mean, we've spent 2+ weeks in quarantine. So is this, you know, one of those topics that's good to talk about on podcasts and so on, because it makes for fascinating conversation, you know, or is there some kind of a fundamental shift happening that will become a new reality post COVID? What do you think of that?
So I see COVID-19 as a forcing function. Essentially, it is going to rapidly accelerate many trends that were already happening. And, you know, there are so many people trying virtualization tools, for example, because now they have no choice. And then they may realize after trying it that, you know, it's not so bad after all. Actually, this crisis creates many new opportunities for things that were there in the future but will be brought forward. So in that sense, what we are seeing is not something that was completely unexpected in terms of adoption of these new technologies, and behavioral adjustments that are happening are more because of the event. But this was going to happen over time, I feel.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's a great note to end on. And this has been a fascinating conversation, guys. Thank you so much. There's a lot of things that we could unpack as well. And I think maybe a follow-up to this is in order sometime. Thank you, everyone, for having listened to this podcast. we will be available, this podcast will be available, sorry, on Anchor, Apple, Google, Spotify, Pocket Casts, and a bunch of other popular platforms. Do stay safe, take care, and if you think this is, you know, great listening to, then please share it with all of your friends and subscribe to us. Until next time, see you. Bye-bye. Jai Hind.